Tools of the trade for urban Yamadori collecting. There it is. Boom. Handsaw, pruners. Maybe a finer saw for the branching because I don't want to just completely destroy a tree that I want to be a beautiful bonsai. And just a, you know, look, if you're using a regular shovel to dig urban Yamadori, you're destroying your feet, your back, and chances are you're destroying the root system. This is a freaking phenomenal digging shovel. This has been with me for 12 years. It has dug a lot of trees, right? Meant to cut through roots, you could even sharpen it. I think we're good to go today because I know this has already been dug once. Pieris is like a broadleaf evergreen species of tree, so it has leaves year-round. Flowers in the spring, it's beautiful, it's scented. They say if horses eat it, it causes them to be inebriated. I haven't tried it, but you know, it's tempting. But I, you know, Randy gave me this piece that he collected out of a landscape in Portland. It was a foundation planting. Pieris is used a lot in the Pacific Northwest, and I just think this tree has tremendous potential. The whole tree twists, has some really wonderful sub-trunking, has some beautiful primary branching, which has evolved in the ground over the course of its time in the landscape here. It's been there for 11 years. So we'll see. We'll see. Urban Yamadori, look, you're digging trees out of ideal circumstances. Typically, they're probably moist or irrigated. They've probably been pruned back and are not stunted because they're struggling, but they're actually thriving, which means the root system is going to be big and powerful. And we have to take a really strategic approach to its extraction. So we'll go up, we'll prune back the canopy to get access to the root system at a size that makes sense for realistic collection. As a bonsai subject coming out of the ground, it's gonna be heavily empowered to produce new roots where we cut. So we wanna make cuts at the right position, but we wanna keep that core root ball intact. That's our main priority anytime we collect anything. Yamadori, field grown stock, urban Yamadori, try to keep a root ball intact, and that means starting at the drip line, or at least the drip line that we reduce to, and then really working down and under that root mass, okay? We can always reduce weight later, but we do not want to break up that root system. So here we go. Prune everything back to a node, which is to say with broadleaf evergreen, I don't want to fully defoliate it. I could technically, but I cannot predict what the tree is going to do if I do such a thing. So I'm just going to cut back to these nodes, but I want to be sure that when I'm cutting and I'm reducing this, that I'm not doing damage. I'm not stripping and breaking these branches and causing sort of irreparable damage, right? And I feel like this part of the process, just investing, you know, I feel like if you're trying to get through the work, yeah, you could very effortlessly sort of kind of blow through this process, but I feel like investing in keeping this tree that you're going to go through this effort with strong and quality and having the branching, I mean, each one of these pieces contributes to a finished tree. Now, a lot of people would say, you know, do we need to reduce branching to be able to balance the reduction of the roots? No, that's not really what we're doing. Does that potentially contribute? Yeah, it might. It possibly could contribute. Look at that. Interesting. It sort of self-layered itself. That's cool. Okay, it could, but I don't think that there's an effort where it's like, hey, you need to reduce this much or else this tree is gonna, you know, not be successful in the collection process. But a lot of that too depends on how much root we're gonna get. And so as I'm kind of doing this, I'm also starting to tease away the duff and just kind of look at what kind of a root system do I have. Obviously, I've planted this tree once. I understand that there's something profound down here that makes me wanna go through this effort, right? You gotta explore urban Yamadori in the same way that you explore Yamadori in the mountains. You've gotta be making sure that this is worth all of the effort you're about ready to dump into this because it's gonna be significant to get this out of the ground. I've been thinking about this for, gosh, I don't know, 10 years now. I thought about it before I ever planted it. Randy and I decided it was probably a little too big. Things have changed. Pieris is notorious for having sort of these big, long, strong kind of internodes. just working, thinking, kind of designing. Feel the old transitional system. Believe it or not, my original planting, literally the root ball is right here, really tight up to the trunk, and maybe we can get back to that, I don't know. And Pieris is very, very slow to thicken, so to get this to callus like this and to form a really solid branch right here, this is probably what makes this so appealing to me, honestly. I do want to take these pieces at the top back, and any of these straight sections, go ahead and take those out, because that already starts to kind of shrink down and reduce the size of the apical region. We can cut out some of these longer pieces, stronger pieces, okay? But leave those branches, leave those transitions of taper. See, in a lot of this, when we're collecting, you know, people cut this off, they cut them way too short, and then all of a sudden you have to regrow everything on a tree that doesn't grow fast enough to recover. You know, and I've wanted to be pruning this, but it's in such a sunny location, and Pieris is a tree that burns very, very easily. And I didn't want to do any damage to this tree until I dug it. So I've really just let it respond and grow on the original prunes. I haven't really done much to this to prepare it for bonsai. All of this is just sort of its natural character that we're working with here. It's so cool. It goes boom, 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 boom. That tight movement up at the top, we can use that. That's value. Can't regrow that. So we would expect for a lot of these smaller branches to probably die upon collection, because we are gonna compromise and reduce the root system. So we're gonna see some natural selection. That's okay. It's okay. Right, as long as we leave some foliage on, just a little bit. A little bit of foliage on, and we get as good of a solid core. And again, this tree has a lot of energy right now. Pruning it when you collect, should I have pruned it last year? Could have, makes it tough to collect when it's wide open. I just decided to wait. It'll push out both foliar as well as roots. Now that I see what everything else looks like. This is about creating the space to extract the tree. I think a lot of broadleaf deciduous and evergreens are cut back way too hard when they're collected. And then afterwards, you've got this big, thick stump, very short internode, big, massive trunk, and then you're gonna what? Grow it out for 10 years to merge that transition of taper? Like, give yourself the space. Give yourself the ability to bend things. Give yourself the ability to style. We can completely alter the structure of this as if we were handling a styling of a conifer. And it's from that perspective, whether we're talking about a maple or we're talking about a beech or we're talking about an elm, right? Those pieces, to cut all of that character off and make those decisions in the field and be too aggressive is the worst thing that you can do to urban Yamadori. Because again, it's in a condition that it's thriving. Take advantage of that vigor and the branching that exists in that scenario. The structure that's there, you cannot regrow again, right? It's gonna take forever. So just be aware, be intentional about the reduction that you do. Do think hard about the choices. And if in doubt, leave it longer. Save movement, create quality lines, because we can always come back and prune back later, okay? All right, it's time to try and see if we can get a shovel underneath this thing. So now we've got basically a reduced foliar mass that allows us to access what we would call the drip line of the tree, okay? And you could argue that the drip line of the tree was where the original foliar mass existed, if that was gonna be the foliar mass we were leaving on the tree. But under the reduced size circumstances, that reduction of that allows us to shrink down the drip mass and start to create a real functional size of root mass for the proportional size of the tree. Now, I do want to say, I'm going to start at or just inside of the drip line to collect a bonsai piece of material. If I were collecting a garden piece of material, I would start at or outside of the drip line. And that is a major nuance difference when we're digging trees for different purposes, okay? But in the case of this Pieris, I'll be digging inside of the drip line of the desired tree, because I know if I can't get this root system down to a size that fits inside of a bonsai container, that I really do have a significant struggle to continue to reduce it over the course of time. Okay, let me show you one more piece before we start digging. I actually can locate right here the two different root systems of when this tree was originally planted. And if you're digging a tree that has been planted within the past 10 years, oftentimes you can kind of find that native nursery soil or softer soil, and then whatever the substrate is that exists in the garden that it's planted in. But it is so much smaller than the size of the root mass that is needed to support this tree, that I'm still gonna work outside of that. And I don't wanna make some sort of assumption that over the past 10 years, this tree hasn't expanded its root system. Here's what I do know. That original root system is where the big thick roots are gonna be. And that's the one thing I wanna keep in mind if I get into a situation where I need to really shorten heavy wood, I can always come back to that, okay? Just inside the drip line for a bonsai piece of urban Yamadori, I want to get down and I want to get under to separate it from the in-ground environment so that I have a nice, solid, intact root ball when this piece comes out. Oh, see that? Anytime you see the tree move, when you're digging, you see the trunk move, that means you're in a significant structural area. There it is. Good. That gives me a good indication that over here, I'm gonna have quite a bit of leverage on the tree. And I'll keep it nice and tight over here. And I'm dealing with the dogwood as well. So once I've gotten around the tree once, I've kind of created, you know, and I went as deep as my shovel could go. You heard me cutting through roots, you know, you're severing all of those connections, and the tree has really started to move. Now I want to go back to those initial areas that I marked where I have leverage on the tree and see if I can't encourage the tree to really come up off of the bottom of that hole that we originally planted it in. Okay, whether we can or we can't, the thing that we have to be cautious of moving forward is becoming impatient and wanting to exert too much force on the tree that would cause the root system to break apart in that root ball that we're trying to maintain intact. If we get leverage on the tree and it doesn't come out or doesn't give us a significant opening to access some of the final roots that are holding it as an anchor, then we need to start pulling back, creating a trench and trying to get under that trunk. So we hope that we can exert leverage at this point in time, having gone in and severed the diagonal and lateral roots, to be able to pop any roots on the bottom and potentially extract this with limited to no additional digging. So let's just see what happens. There you are. Okay, it looks like I still got a hold over here somewhere. This is what urban Yamadori looks like. Look, anytime you dig a tree that is in a circumstance where it's thriving, it's not easy. Hey, bonsai isn't easy. It's not a low level investment. It's not a small amount of work, but you gotta love it. You gotta love this stuff. This thing is gonna be badass. Totally worth it. And it's coming out, and it's coming out in a really beautiful way. I'm pretty excited to see if we can't get it to pop. Here we go, we're gonna re-engage. Okay, that feels good. There you are, baby. See it? There we go. Okay, let's see. I think we got it to pop. Whew. Whew. Notice how beautiful and intact the root ball is. And you saw how I use my shovel, hand and shovel, use your shovel as a leverage. The advantage of those digging shovels and that heavy diameter handle, the weakness on your digging shovel is gonna be flexibility and thinness of the digging spade itself. This one's pretty rigid. It makes it a lot heavier to handle, but man, you see how effective that is. Okay, so now I need to go about this like I would a bonsai repot. From the perspective of, the last thing I want to do is plant this whole thing in a container right now. That would be an absolute nightmare. We would never, ever be able to reduce this root ball any farther. When we take a tree out of the field, we want to reduce it to the root system that allows it to become a bonsai. This is that kill it or make it a bonsai moment. So I'm going to go get some chopsticks, and I'm going to go ahead and take down the height. But I first want to explore, where are my structural roots at the base here? And how much of this can I get rid of to kind of shed the weight of the soil, find the nabari, and really start to look at reducing the bottom in a manner that doesn't design the tree, but in a manner that might contribute to the design of the tree. Okay, ultimately planting angle, everything else is about survivability. If you plant a root system this big, it's never gonna become a bonsai. You do have to take the moment, you have to take that initiative, and now is the time to reduce it to a size that makes it workable for you. Okay, so we're gonna get some stuff. We're gonna see if we can bring this down, the weight, the size, the depth, to create something proportional and usable in the bonsai form. Getting into some of the native clay, maybe that it was grown in, who knows, you know. It's tough to say where these trees came from in terms of the garden environment. I have some roots that are, you know, much bigger and severed that I'm happy to just get out of the way so that we can kind of focus on the roots that sustain the tree. But you can already kind of see that it's going to thin down to a very, very small, very, very small root mass relatively quickly. Okay, here's a big, thick root. That's our first big structural root that we've found. I want to go ahead and I want to chase that back to where that joins the trunk, because that becomes a pivotal feature for the design. You know, and if we had some root ball that was falling apart, we would probably organically see some of this. But because we got such a big, solid, beautiful, intact root mass, we kind of have to go finding this stuff to help inform how we want to, you know, kind of proceed with the rest of the handling of the roots. I do have some clay in here that doesn't have a lot of root mass. I can kind of drop some of those big clay particles off until I hit a dense patch of roots where the root mass holds together and there's something that actually preserves that. But this root, that structural piece is really stunning, and I see that circling around towards the front. So I'm just gonna kind of pursue that and see what we get. Okay, over here it feels like I'm not gonna have much. Nice, nice, beautiful root. Over here, let me get rid of some of this. Get rid of some of this clay. Let me just take down the surface to show some of this structural. Oh, nice. Yes. Now we recognize the more that we take off here prior to potting, that the more fragile it's going to be. So I do want to kind of temper my desire to really go super hard. But the more that I reduce, the lighter the entire thing gets. And we're able to transport it, move it. We understand the size of the box, okay? And when we talk about collected material, Yamadori or urban Yamadori, the smaller the box that we are able to put it in, or the smaller the container we're able to put it in, okay, the faster this piece is gonna recover because the balance of water and oxygen is there. And that's really what we're looking for, not having too much water sitting around this tree's root system, okay? Oh, great. Okay, now, if we were digging a conifer, I would be far, far, far more careful in this reduction process. Because this is a broadleaf evergreen, has a little bit higher capacity to tolerate reduction in a single go,
right, has a little bit more of a capacity to have less soil on its root system and still be viable. So I'm being aggressive based on the fact that it's a broadleaf. That is a major, major point of distinction in handling. I would be far more conservative if this were a conifer, okay? So I've literally reduced the root system by half of the depth, okay, and significantly reduced the width of the root system over here and a significant amount of the weight as well. Okay, and I just wanna see, can I take this down and get this cone kind of out of the center so that this thing would essentially and effectively sit flat with the Nabari that we're finding? And I think a willingness, there does have to be a willingness to come back and reduce this root system. This is scary when you value a tree. To come back in and pull this back as if you're doing a repot. We think, yeah, oh, we just want it to survive and then we'll deal with it later. No, this is the moment on a tree that's coming out of a condition in which it's thriving, right? The urban Yamadori system, again, most likely irrigated, most likely cared for, manicured, domestic situation. It's not ruggedness, it's position, variety, pruning and maintenance over the course of time, but the resources in the root system have always been there. Okay, that's what we're approaching this with. And I'm starting to hit structural roots on the bottom here now, which is a great delineation. Now look at what that does. I have literally 3-4 inches of root space. I have a tag from a Shimpaku juniper that I'll leave for future generations as a time capsule in the hole at Mirai. They'll say, wow, Ryan Neal was digging Shimpaku juniper here someday. Okay, and I'm gonna go ahead and any of those roots that were damaged, I'm gonna cleanly cut these. I'm gonna cleanly cut any of these roots that were damaged in collection. That's why I have a saw and that's why I also have my root cutter. Okay, and a clean cut means that it'll compartmentalize. And you see how torn up that is from the shovel going through it. The shovel, yes, it cuts, does tend to do quite a bit of damage, just a nice clean cut right there. And what we leave behind will very easily produce roots with the energy system that this tree has stored from the in-ground environment. So I clean those up as I go and just keep producing. I like to keep any dig site as clean and organized as possible. Just good practice. Good, solid, intentional practice in bonsai to keep your working spaces clean. Okay, there's that structural root. We recognize the weight of the tree is kind of sitting on that worked root system already. So we're just being careful to not apply too much pressure. We recognize we're reducing the weight. Okay, there's not a lot of structural root in there. That's wonderful. This is where the hollow is, so I'm assuming this is also gonna give us something interesting over here. Okay, we've got some surface pieces that exist. These look like these were rooted branches. I'm gonna take that off. Great. Yeah, great. Nice. Things that do not have to do with my Pieris can come out. We have the dogwood behind it. Seeing a lot of dogwood stuff come out. Now you notice I'm not keeping the roots moist and I'm not fussing too much with that. Okay, if you work quick, these roots can stay fairly air dry for almost over a day and still be viable, right? I would say if you're in extreme conditions, if the tree is being dug at a wrong time of year, you want to invest a lot more energy in that. But right now where we're at, the season, the state of growth, this tree not having produced a full first flush that's matured, I feel totally comfortable letting the roots get a little bit drier. Okay, and I'm getting down to where those surface branches were coming out. I know that I've got to have, there's some structural goodness right there. Okay, so I'm just starting to get down to it right here. By the time we're done, this is gonna look like a bonsai root system because we'll have eliminated so much of the mass that existed on the trunk and everything else. We'll have the Nabari defined. Here's the
thick piece. There's that big beefy piece right there. Okay, I'm pretty happy with that. This is a patch of roots that I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna sacrifice, which I don't do that much. But that's coming off of a portion of the trunk that I think gives us a lot of girth and a lot of visibility. Okay, beautiful. There's some thick structural roots. There's my thick structural root. I think this is probably where we say, you know, this is our base as it exists on this piece of material in this tree. And this is where we're gonna kind of stop that reduction until we know further, okay? Let me see if I can just get some of this out. Yeah. Let this can sit flat. Sublime. Everything twisting. Yay, good.
One of the things that we really have to embrace in this process of urban Yamadori is the smallest possible box, right, to allow this tree to recover. And what oftentimes happens is when we utilize a smaller box, we see the tree recover much faster because we're dealing with a soil system that is reoccupied, that determines the boundaries of the foliar mass it can push, that strikes the balance of water and oxygen. So as I sit here and I look at this, now that it's extracted, now that we've moved it, this is the moment where I can truly reduce the root system. Okay, now I wanna think about my limitations when constructing this box because I have this big solid structural root over here that kind of creates a lateral boundary that's going to be a bare minimum, right? And when I start to think about that, even though my root system has a structure that would suggest that this is kind of in a corner, I really want that to be a lateral distance. And I'm not worried about getting the front correct. I'm not worried about getting the angle correct. I'm worried about getting the box size correct here, okay? Okay, if I just kind of take that as my lateral distance, I see that 24 inches gives me about an inch of space roughly on the outer margin of this from this right side to this left side. Again, I don't know what the front is. Now let me see what 24 inches gives me front to back. Now 24 inches front to back gives me about an inch of space on both sides of the root system. I would say I can further reduce this and put this into a smaller box. And if that is the case, again, now is the time to go ahead and take this back, even though we are exposing a lot of fine roots, that's totally acceptable and that's totally okay. In fact, the more when we have a really healthy, solid tree like this that was growing super vigorously in the in-ground environment, now is the time to do the heavy reduction and allow all of that power and all of that stored energy to go ahead and provide those roots the capacity to start to compartmentalize at the length we desire for the eventual bonsai container, okay? And this is that crux, very significant crux moment of root reduction when the tree has the greatest amount of power. Now, if I didn't have this kind of root system, if I didn't have this kind of stability, if this thing fell apart and bare rooted, there's nothing we can do because that is a catastrophic event. But because it held together, because it has a wonderful structure and shape, and because we have such a tremendous amount of fine roots, this is why we can go about this reduction process. And if you can, you should, because you set yourself up for a far greater degree of success in the future. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna neck this down. If I can get this below 24 inches, and I could get one of, when we think about this, an informal upright tree, just in terms of bonsai, we're thinking, okay, an oval or a rectangle. And again, because it came out of the in-ground environment with this kind of strength and we have such a solid system, this is why we can consider these things. I'm sitting here looking at this and I'm saying, okay, oval or rectangle, I wanna make this as small as it can possibly be while still maintaining and continuing to present and preserve as much of the root as I'm gonna need for this to seamlessly transition from this collecting process. I'm getting close, but let's go ahead and get it down a little further.
I think we could get away with 6 as a depth factor, the shallower the better. And we might just be able to go 1 board high, which would be ideal. We don't want to plant this super deep in a box. I like that.
I like that. And that is nice and reduced. Okay, and we'll cut these thick roots one more time. One more time. Beautiful. And we're ready. Let's go build a box. 19. Look at that. You know, when you think about the box, cedar's always been a really nice, relatively durable, affordable cedar fencing. It's thin, it's breathable, it's light. You know, and even though we're dealing with a really heavy tree, having the smallest, lightest box possible and planning on 2 years max out of the life of this box, for me, is the best way to go about box construction. You can always over-engineer a box, but then you lose the benefit of the oxygen moisture exchange, the lightness. You lose a lot of the nuances that make a wood box beneficial. Big, heavy lumber starts to become an impediment to the tree really having the benefits of that environment. So I like to keep it small, and I like to keep it minimal, and I like to keep it simple, okay? So we're just gonna tack this together in the corners. We'll put a triangle on top of all 4 of the corners to hold it together for the 2 years. We're gonna have our runner on the bottom, and then we'll have some pieces that elevate it off of the ground so that we can move it with the forks. But that's the extent of our box, and that's how we're gonna kind of go about the building process. So let me go ahead and screw this together and put the floor together, and we'll see how that box construction kind of ends up. I know the lateral distance of my tree is gonna run right to left. This is 14 gauge galvanized steel. And I see that upper crotch of the tree. I wanna create a triangle, upper crotch of the tree to both sides of the box. We're gonna go around twice. It's one of the very best ways to tie a tree in. If we wanted to do it another way, we could create slats on the side with a bridge across the box, and we could tie the tree to that bridge because we went with a very lightweight cedar box. I'm gonna go with the downward force applied to the bigger structural element, which we ran those struts along the bottom. But there's so many different ways to do this. The key is to do it lightly, elegantly, and efficiently. You don't want this to be a big, massive construction, because here's what happens. The excitement of the collect, it makes you, you're so pumped, and you get it out of the ground and you get it home, and then you have, after that kind of effort, exertion, you have a massive boxing scenario where you've got to construct a bunch of stuff. It's very physical. You don't get to it for 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 10 days. You're like, gosh, it's not even worth it. I don't like that tree that much. It's too, you know, like, don't start the process. That is a slippery slope, and it is a recipe for disaster. Make this box construction as effortless as it can possibly be. Low impact, and making sure that you have the ability to meet the demands of the tree after you collect it. So just making this concise, making the box concise, and going about this process. Now I'm gonna measure out 2 full revolutions. So I just like to get a really nice long length And then I kind of straighten both of these pieces, preventing the steel from kinking, right? And if I guesstimated it correctly, which most of the time I do, occasionally I don't, let's hope this one goes well, because this is an awful lot of 14 gauge steel. Okay, big tree, bigger wire, your 17 gauge galvanized steel is gonna have a hard time holding this. Okay, I should be able to come up over the top. So I'm just gonna place this. I'm proactively setting myself up for success, okay? There's my anchor tie down wires. I'm gonna go ahead, I'm gonna leave these out here, kind of hook them so that I don't get smacked in the face as I'm doing the other stuff I need to think about. I'm collecting urban Yamadori and I want it to develop because I cut it back. It was a big stump. I'm gonna have to grow leaders. Okay, that's very coarse primary structure that you're trying to cultivate. And when we do that, we need to cultivate roots that facilitate that primary structure, okay? So you are customizing your soil system to the type of roots that you are trying to grow. And that's where we would say with a broadleaf tree, we would go 70% organic, 30% aggregate, and I love pumice as that aggregate, okay? What is that organic? Is that decomposed pine bark, sifted decomposed pine bark? Is that some sort of nursery mix, a peat, perlite sand mix? Is that some sort of bagged potting soil? Yeah, sure, any of those, right? Any of those. I like nursery mix. I like to go lighter, airier. I like decomposed pine bark. I think it's great. That feels good to me. When we are trying to cultivate fine roots to go into a bonsai container, however, even with a broadleaf tree, I do like to lean on pumice heavily. And so we're gonna go with a solid pumice mixture, which is historically standard for conifers only, but it does create the finest roots. And I don't need this Pieris to produce these big coarse roots and developmental growth. So I'm gonna go straight solid pumice, but I'm going to go 1/16 to 1/4. I'm gonna put my aeration, just a thin sheet so that I don't lose too much pumice out of the bottom. And I'm gonna do 1/16 to 1/4 interior around this piece. Now I wanna sit this root system down on the bottom of the box. We're maxing out the height of the box right here. In fact, I'm gonna have to reduce the root system a little bit more. So I'm not gonna build up a heavy soil level, and you never wanna put living roots in the middle of a box. You wanna put them at the bottom or at the top, preferably at the bottom so that you don't have excess soil to get them to the top. And that's how we get the best balance of water and oxygen. We keep the roots warm so they can grow, and we avoid those spots in the middle that are cold, wet, and they atrophy in terms of root growth, okay? So I'm gonna set up my soil system. I've got my 1/4 to 1/2 as my bottom layer, and this is more functional. And then I'm gonna do my center mound, okay? And I want this center mound because I'm gonna settle this tree in. I don't wanna have to chopstick a tremendous amount of the root system here. I wanna settle this in and have that that pumice displaced to those outer walls. So I'm gonna go big center round. I'm gonna reduce the amount of work that I have to do, okay? And I might even go ahead and just distribute this so that it's not so barren out in those areas. Okay, a little bit more here. And that feels pretty good. So I'm just gonna go up onto an area that feels as though it has a good solid capacity to hold that weight without the root system bending. Let's get these down. These will be an impediment in a bonsai container. They certainly are an impediment for this box. Let's go ahead and get them out of the way now. Let's not have to come back and whittle away at this in the future. Yeah, we'll get some of that dirt out of there. That feels like that's gonna be good. Okay, all right, are we ready? I'm just gonna go straight up into the box now. I know that my lateral side, hopefully all distance, is well gauged. Okay. Looks like I have a little bit of reduction that needs done over here. My lateral distance works out quite well. Let me see what I got. There we go. Nice and into the container. That'll go down and in. It's a little bit high here. I would love for that to be in. We may have to boost the height just a bit on that wall, but all in all, pretty darn decent. We've got our big root over in there. We've got some space. I even have what I would consider to be a little bit of excess space, which I'm not super ecstatic about, but I'll take it. beggars can't be choosers, and this has been a very rapid, very, very rapid urban Yamadori dig. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead, I'm gonna carry this wire through this space, the wire alone, and it holds the position. And I'm just going up through that crotch, and I'm gonna bring it right over here, right over to the diagonal here. This should allow us good tight holding capacity. Yeah, good. All right, that tree's not gonna go anywhere. Heavily bound to the box, and then we'll tighten on both of these. I'll obviously tighten over here first. Let me go ahead and get just a little bit more. Okay, good. Okay, so I'm gonna scrape this soil, move this sideways. I feel pretty good about the root system that we've got going here, okay? Cut off any long, leggy, damaged roots in the process. Just clean everything up. Make sure everything's clean when we do this. Okay, even though the tree hasn't necessarily survived yet, let's go ahead and assume that this is gonna be an incredibly, incredibly valuable tree. And treat it as such. Treat it as if it's gonna be incredibly valuable. Okay, now you might be saying, why didn't you build a deeper box? Just build a deep, no. You don't want to oversize the box. That's the whole point of this, and talking about really solid collecting practices. Shrink the box down. Yeah, I could increase the height. Obviously, I could increase the height. I understand that. But if I increase the height, I'm using a bigger soil volume. I already have a little bit too much on the sides compared to what I want to see, right? I don't want to have more. I want to keep this as neck down as possible, okay? So these roots that I have, if they need to be layered, we would layer them, not nearly as detailed or intricately as we would in a bonsai container. But once we start to fill this with soil, all of these roots get nice and pinned down by the presence of that pumice. And anything that comes back up, we're gonna go ahead and we're just gonna take off. To dig a piece of urban Yamadori of this size and film it in a single day, I feel accomplished. Looks pretty good. It's pretty awesome. A little big, but we'll cut it back a little bit more once it's boxed. I'll make a few final cutbacks. Good. Okay, now, I'm gonna mound this soil up. I want quite a bit of soil. And here's the thing about making a box that's very small, is we do have to chopstick soil, right? That big center mound was the biggest thing we can do to minimize the amount of chopsticking that we need to apply to this, because we don't want to chopstick this as if it's a bonsai. It's not even remotely close to that kind of level of cultivation and technique yet. We just can't have big glaring air spaces in the soil system. Okay, and because we had so many fine roots, again, you know, drawing the difference between regular Yamadori and urban Yamadori is so necessary when we have this conversation. Tree that has resources. This is a tree that has energy. This is a tree that has roots. This is a tree that has plenty. It's not starving. That's not what creates the aesthetic of urban Yamadori. Quite the opposite, right? Even in the most neglected circumstance, urban Yamadori is far better off and in far better condition when we collect than regular Yamadori, okay? So I just wanna make sure that I integrate that pumice into those air spaces, kind of feel around the perimeter of the root mass. Doesn't need to be rock solid. I'm not gonna spend a lot of time on it. I just wanna make sure that I'm not leaving any big, open, nasty spaces that could allow those fine roots that we know exist inside of this system to rot. And that's what would happen. That's really where root rot comes in, is when they're just big oxygen spaces in the soil system, okay? So just integrating. Then we also know that you're talking about a very, very clay, heavy clay soil.
here, right? So it's got a lot of holding capacity. It's got a lot of roots that exist in the clay. You're gonna get rapid recovery in this pumice of really, really fine roots that can contribute and maybe even empower you to come back in and remove a majority of this clay. Okay, so let's go ahead and let's clean her up. We'll do the final trim and we are out of here. An amazing, I think, collect today. Went as well as it could have from so many different considerations. Now, again, I'm not concerned about the front. I'm not looking at angle. I'm not looking at design, because now we have to let the tree recover. And by pruning so much of the top, and I think there's more to be pruned, you know, my ideal apex will be as tall as these structural branches at the very height of it. These pieces will be brought down and then back up. We'll lower the apex. It'll cover this section. And you can expect to see a very, very nice compact Pieris in the finished product of this. As a result, maybe we do go ahead and shorten some of these structural pieces back to some of these finer little spots that exist and assume that we're gonna be building off of branches that elongate from there, but we just have to let the tree recover. And again, this is where you have to be very careful to try and design a collected piece of material, whether it be urban or whether it be from the native environment, because it's up to the tree now. We did everything we possibly could. What we knew we absolutely could not use, right? We're not trying to design there. We're not cutting back too far to get ahead of ourselves and have to regrow something that already existed. We're cutting back just what was necessary to get it out of the ground. We brought it sustainably, reduced the size of the root system, thought about the eventual bonsai size. We built a box that minimized the amount of negative space. We shoehorned the tree into it, knowing that's gonna help us in the recovery process. We had an efficient box constructing methodology, and it's worked out beautifully in terms of fitting a really nice tight squeeze for this tree. Now, after integrating that pumice in a very light and very efficient, not aggressive, not overly done way, just integrating it into the large spaces, we kind of get that quarter inch for the water to hit the edge of the box and stay inside of that container. We recognize pumice is going to move water more quickly. Now it's time to thoroughly saturate. Simple anchor, simple box, simple process, urban Yamadori. Highest chance of success is every single aspect of the operation going smoothly and the most simple methodology possible. That is how we achieve success. Okay, we're gonna water this in thoroughly. Saturate, soak, wash through the pumice. We've got those big aeration strips underneath the boards of the box here. And then we'll leave this in a very wind-protected morning sun, afternoon shade environment outside in the garden so that it can acclimate, recover, and start to produce new roots that will generate interior growth and backbudding and allow this tree to start to flourish in its next iteration. Thank you so much for tuning in. Urban Yamadori, you are now empowered with the knowledge. You understand what to do, you know what it looks like, and you know what you're trying to achieve. Go find those trees. Landscapes throughout the country are waiting for you to find bonsai potential in them. Rock out, use these skills that you've built, and we look forward to seeing your urban Yamadori become bonsai very, very soon.